looking for the Sunday school children, if they would come up front. We need to do a little choir practice before the service. They have some songs they want to teach you. So if they would all come up front here. The children of our Sunday school are going to take a leadership role in this morning's service. They're going to read the lessons, do the prayers. I think they've been helping as greeters and helping to hand out bulletins. And they've got some songs to teach you. Good job. We've been practicing the last couple of weeks. I've been ducking out during the sermon and meeting with these guys. They have good voices. Come on up. The first song we would like to teach you is the opening hymn. It's not in your bulletin. It's actually in your hymnal, but you don't need it. You don't need the hymnal because what you're going to sing, we're going to do We have seen the Lord.
We have seen the Lord. We have seen the Lord. God with us, Jesus Christ.
So the words are really hard. We have seen the Lord. And then at the end, it's God with us, Jesus Christ. So we'll do it again, and then you sing with us.
We have seen the Lord. We have seen the Lord. We
don't we love when your little sister's around?
No, okay. Right?
How about we just start with Holy Communion with you? Skip the little shot glasses, we're going right for the whole cup. Okay. We got a couple things coming up over the next few weeks. We have a catechetical overnight. A few weeks after that, actually about 4 or 5 weeks after that, we're taking the students to Harrisburg. They will open the session, they will open the house. They'll be on the floor, and then they'll get a tour. Our local representative, David Maloney, is going to be hosting us. And he really steps up to the plate, and that when we arrive, he recognizes that these are students and that this is a future political system, and that we have an opportunity to make something really, really good. I'm hoping that message gets back to him. We're on TV, right? That's why I want it, because I'm making a political announcement right now. I want to make sure that our students learn early on that they have voice and that they have power. We saw that happen in Florida. We're going to see it all over the country, and I'm really glad. There's a place in the Bible written 2,000 years ago and said, and the little children will lead them. And sometimes that's what it takes. So Cameron, thank you for your usher badge that you're wearing right now, because you are one of our leaders. Do you want to stand up here for a second, please? Quickly. Would you like to take a bow? Do you know what a bow is? Okay, let's see it. Do you know what a curtsy is? Good, good. I like that. And Tanzania. I love Tanzania. You know that, don't you? Yep, there's nothing like Tanzania. If you ever have a chance, a Tanzanian sunset. How many hundred people do we have in Boyertown?
About 4,000.
About 4,000? Well, I know 38%, right? 38% of our school district receives a state or federally funded meal or multiple meals. So if we're at 38%, how many students do we have in our district? 38%, let's just go down. Let's say 3 cents, 1,800 students. I've got too much feedback on this. So when we've got 1,800 students that are hungry, what can we do to help feed them? We tried this 3 years ago, and we failed. We failed because we allowed the political nature of our system to get in the way. No more. No more. Mouths need to be fed. Let's make sure we feed our kids. We've got money in our congregation, and more than that, we've got you. And I know that your hearts are big. I know that they are swollen, that you want our students being fed, because if they're not being fed, how are they going to learn? If they don't learn, how are we going to climb the ladder of educational excellence around the globe? That, to me, sounds like something that we need to take care of. Can you wrap your head around that for the next 12 months?
Yes.
Maybe not. Okay. Yes. Thank you for that rousing support. Yes. All right. We want to support this, right? Yes. Yes. See that resurrection power is available to us if we simply make it put to use. Today's lessons are about Thomas, doubting. Some people come to church because they want God to be happy, and I'm sure that coming to church makes God happy, but that's not a reason to come to church. Some people come to church because they want to receive the sacrament of Holy Communion and baptism. That's nice. It really is nice to celebrate that which Martin Luther said during a protesting movement 500 years ago, that those were our two sacraments, and those Catholics, man, they got it wrong with all those others, right? Hey, if any of you are married, you know that marriage is a sacrament. And if you haven't figured it out by now, you will. I'll talk about that in the sermon too. Lots available to us today. We come to worship so that we can draw closer to a Savior that desires to draw closer to us. And in fact, the best way to come to worship is knowing, looking, and watching for God to join you, because God wants to join you in what God is up to here in Boyertown, Pennsylvania, and beyond.
Good morning. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Jason Frizz, and I'm a member of council. And I wanted to share with you where I saw God at work this week. Specifically, starting with my family. This morning, two little girls, Alina and Cameron, Alina asked Cameron if she could do her hair this morning before church. If you live in my house, that doesn't happen. That was God at work. It was only 10 minutes, but it was God at work. Also this week in my relationship with my wife, we celebrated 16 years. 16 years on Friday. I'm continually blessed by God in my marriage and with my family daily. I wasn't here at church with you all last week. We departed Pennsylvania and went to Connecticut for the weekend and got to spend some time with some very close friends. While there, I got to meet two beautiful twin girls, 5 months, and I finally got to meet them. Jen was there their second week, but just absolutely beautiful little girls, God at work. Also, I was able to watch Easter service, so I did miss it last week, obviously, but with the YouTube channel, I was able to watch it yesterday, and something stuck out to me while I was watching it. Believe it or not, I was watching it and putting in hardwood floor at my house at the same time. But during communion, a few things stuck out to me. It's funny that, like, we see people come to the table every week, but it's, you don't really think about it. And I've started thinking about it more and more the last couple of months. It's funny how there's always enough for everybody. God made enough for us all, enough food, enough wine, enough love. There's enough grace for all of us. No one ever takes more than they need. And everyone gets served. I think that's what God wants for all of us and also for this world. So I just wanted to share that, and that's where I've seen God at work this week. Thank you.
Well, I'm Roz Motes, and I'm not a member of council, but I saw God at work this week in a way that I just needed to share. So one of our members here, who's fighting a battle with cancer, contacted me, and she said, I saw that you are looking for more people to become prayer members. And she said, Roz, I can't come to church right now, and I'm struggling. Some weeks are good, some weeks are bad. But one thing that I can do is I can pray at home. She said, is that good enough to be one of our prayer team members? I said, absolutely. So Janet Wadsworth is one of our new prayer team members, and she wants to pray for others from her home, even though she can't come and worship with us, because she has been so blessed by all the prayers that we have lifted up for her during her struggles. So she's paying it forward to the rest of you. And that's where I've seen God at work this week.
Good morning. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with the power through the Holy Spirit that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. You may rise. The peace of the Lord be with you. Let us pray. Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. That was an exciting hymn.
Okay, sorry. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray.
Thank you.
us pray. Almighty God, with joy we celebrate the day of our Lord's resurrection. By the grace of Christ among us, enable us to show the power of the resurrection in all that we say and do. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
None of them claimed that their possessions were on their own, and they shared everything they had with each other. In a powerful way, the apostles told everyone that the Lord was now alive. God greatly blessed his followers, and no one went in need of anything. Everyone who owned land or houses would sell them and bring the money into the apostles. Then they would give the money to anyone who needed it. Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Washes all of our sins away. If we say that we have not sinned, we are fooling ourselves, and the truth is not in our hearts. But if we confess our sins to God, He can always be trusted to forgive us and take our sins away. If we say that we have not sinned, we make God a liar, and His message is not in our hearts. My children, I am writing this so that you will not sin, but if you do sin, Jesus Christ always does the right thing, and He will always speak to the Father for us. Christ is the sacrifice that takes away our sins and the sins of all the world's people. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Holy Gospel of our Lord according to St. John. Carly, I don't think I can read as well as you read. You're in first grade? That was amazing. That was beautiful. I could hear what I think God wanted us to hear. Thank you. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, he said that he needed a glass of water. Receive the wow. Carly, you want to finish this? Yeah. Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained. But Thomas, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Coffee? Cream? What was it? Oh, thank you. Peppermint. Sounds good. Let's see if this works. No, I'll be fine, but thank you. When I was about 6, I pestered my parents for fish. I wanted an aquarium. And I pestered for quite some time, and throughout that time of bothering them, I wanted tropical fish. My parents kept saying, "You know, if you get them, they're yours. They're your responsibility. We're not going to clean the tank. We're not going to feed them. We're not going to do anything." Well, my pesting won out. And the reason it won out is because my sister was born. So I think as a concession, I got the aquarium. And I'll tell you what, the first few days, I had no problem turning on the light. I had no problem feeding them the little fish flakes. I had no problem even the first time I had to clean the tank. But when it came time for the second time around and the third time around, I've got to be honest with you, I was really, really happy for that ceremonial toilet journey. I was grateful to no longer be stuck with them. And that was the end of the aquarium. May Fern, I'm in the middle of a sermon. So what about Jesus? Jesus was for at least 3 years with the same crew. Jesus ate with them at the same table, all 12 of them, for 3 years in a row. He walked the same roads with them. He rode in the same boat with them. He visited the same homes with them. He did everything with them for 3 years. Now, I don't know about you, but that's tough enough. But then add to it and think about the person we're talking about. We are talking about Jesus. Not only did Jesus have to put up with their visible oddities, can you see them fighting? Who's going to sit closest to Jesus? Who's going to get the biggest manna burger? Who's going to get whatever? Can you see not just the visible oddities, but Jesus had to put up with the invisible oddities. He had to put up with the words that they were thinking, but were unspoken. He knew their private doubts, and he knew their future doubts. How would you like it? Would you really want to know everything about your spouse, your partner's history? You want to know every gory detail of their lives? Do you want to know their every thought of your behavior? Do you want to know every time they are irritated with you? Do you want to know every time they're upset with you? Do you want to know every time they're angry with you? Do you want to know every time they think you're about the strangest thing that they've ever done in their whole life? Do you really want to be able to read someone's mind? Know their thoughts and know their doubts and know their not so nice things? Do you think it was hard for Jesus to love Peter, knowing that Peter would deny him 3 times? Do you think it was hard for Jesus to love Thomas, knowing that Thomas would question and doubt his resurrection? I'm not sure how Jesus resisted the urge to just kind of send them all packing and get the second team up to bat to carry out the mission of moving forward Jesus' message for the rest of the existence of the world. John wanted to destroy one enemy. Peter sliced off the ear of another. Just a few days before Jesus died, they were arguing over which one of them is the best. Sounds like a council meeting in some other church. Few things stir panic as being stuck in a relationship, not knowing what to do, how to proceed, how to get your heart's desire on the table and addressed. I think that in the 20th chapter of John, the passage that was read for us and the passage that I read, I think that one, along with the 13th chapter of John, we get to see a picture, a glimmer of what Jesus wants in our relationships. For Thomas, and in the 13th chapter of John, do you recall the scene? 13 John, do you recall when Jesus gathered the boys in the upper room? The evening meal was being served, and the devil had already prompted Judas Iscariot, son of Simon, to betray Jesus. Jesus knew that the Father had put all things under his power and that he had come from God and was returning to God. So he got up from the meal, took off his outer clothing, and what happened? Yeah, but get yourself into the scene. This is Jerusalem. This is a dirty, dusty, packed city. It's Passover, so everybody was in town. Not just for the Passover, to observe it and to celebrate it, but also to get a glimpse of this teacher, the one that they've been hearing about for 3 years. And Jesus was traveling in the area, and they knew if they were going to get just the tiniest glimpse of him, Jerusalem was the place to be. It was a long day. It was nighttime. They had went to the room upstairs, they'd gone to the room upstairs, and they gathered around a table, and the 12 were seated, and Jesus entered in, and they all saw the towel on the wall, they all saw the pitcher and the basin on the floor, and they waited, and Jesus waited and paused just long enough for them to recognize what was about to happen. Jesus took off his outer garment, and he put on the servant's garment. And I think the most passionate scene of all scripture is when Jesus took a knee and he stood before his filthy, dirty, soon to commit a vile act group of disciples, and he washed their feet. The same hands that shaped the stars were scraping off the dirt, the same fingers that moved mountains, touched people, and with a touch were healed, now are massaging the feet. 24 of them. Jesus knows what's going to happen in the next 24 hours. He knows that his hands are going to be pierced. He knows his side is going to be ripped open. He knows his head's going to have blood streaming down from his forehead because of a crown of thorns. He knew that he would be mocked. He knew that he would be jeered. He knew that he would be embarrassed. He would be humiliated. And he knew that the same feet that he was washing were the ones that were going to very quickly run away. All but one guy. He didn't even make it to the Garden of Gethsemane. He barely made it out of the upper room, Judas. He knew that only one would be close to him at the point of his death. I looked for a Bible translation with Judas, and I was looking for one that said Jesus washed all of the disciples' feet except the feet of Judas, but I couldn't find it. I don't think I would have washed his feet knowing that he was about to do what he was about to do. The same feet that Jesus washed will be the same feet that they will see the following morning when their heads and faces will be in their hands and they'll be staring down at the ground. He doesn't want to just clean their feet. He wants to cleanse their heart. He doesn't want to just wash away the dirt. He wants to wash away their doubts. Remember what I said earlier? He could read their thoughts, and he knew even their future thoughts. He knew these 12. One would betray him, one would deny him, and the others would run away when the temperature would get too hot in the kitchen of redemption. The kitchen of salvation. Jesus washes our feet for two reasons. He washes them so that we can understand and experience mercy. Getting something that we deserve taken away from us. I deserve the traffic ticket as I'm traveling down Route 100, and I get a pass. I deserve eternal separation from God because of even my thoughts, let alone my actions. I get a pass. But it's not a free pass. It's a pass that cost Jesus his life. It's a pass that's revealed in this incredibly passionate and intimate story of Jesus removing not just the dirt, but the doubt. I thought about it again today. I think because I'm getting older, I'm beginning to realize that sometimes you can't preach a sermon with words. Sometimes you have to preach it with your actions. Today, maybe today was the day that I should have said, "Hey, you, come on up here. Allow me to take your shoe off. Allow me to take your sock off. Allow me to reveal that you need a pedicure. Allow me to wash away the dirt and grime of sock fuzz." I wonder what it was like for Mary and Martha and for the perfumed oil being poured out on Jesus' feet, washing his feet, kissing his feet. It's an act of passion. It's an act of intimacy. The other reason, not just mercy, but the other reason I think Jesus washes the feet of the disciples is so that they know that his love is unconditional, that he's willing to move to the posture of a servant, the lowest person in the pecking order, the one whose hands and knees get dirty. Isn't that the kind of person that we like? Don't we like the one that helps out in the kitchen when it's time for a fellowship meal? The one that will quietly, without any kind of notice, be over there scrubbing the dishes? Don't we like it when someone takes out the trash? How many times have we walked past the overflowing trash can with hopes that someone else will pick up that duty? How many times have we walked past paper in our own parking lot, in our own grass, someone else's job? How many times have we walked past the woman who stinks and the gentleman who smells even worse on the streets, Or worse yet, we move to the other side because we don't want to see their eyes. We don't want to hear their begging. We don't want to reject them. We don't want to turn them away. And Jesus washing the disciples' feet is an example for us to not flee, to not fight, but to forgive. Forgive ourselves for the hungry and the homeless. Forgive ourselves when our bellies are full and theirs are empty. Forgive ourselves when we can transport all kinds of miles and go to all kinds of things and spend money on everything and anything. And they have nothing. I met with a family this week. They were going through a very serious time in their life and their marriage. Gentleman's wife discovered that a decade and a half ago, while they were married, there was an indiscretion. And then he discovered that there were more indiscretions. There were lots more. And while he'd been faithful for 15 years, in their marriage he had not been. And at the suggestion of a friend, they went away, and they talked a lot, and they walked a lot, and they cried a lot, and they hurt a lot. And on the second to the last day of their trip, on his pillow, he found a note. I'd rather be doing nothing with you than something with someone else. And then she wrote, "I forgive you. I love you. Let's move on." It's as if that card may have been the basin of water, that pen, pouring out of mercy. He didn't deserve what he got. I think there are certain conflicts in all of our lives that require a basin. I think there are certain conflicts in all of our lives that should move us to be still and to either receive the poured out mercy or to be the one who does the pouring. I wonder if there's anyone sitting here in this room that needs to assure a friend, a family member, a spouse, a child, maybe even your pastor, of grace and mercy. Again, Jesus made sure in his last night that his only task at hand was to make absolutely certain that his disciples knew that he loved them, and that they didn't have to have any doubts. But then there's Thomas. Thomas, who the week after the crucifixion, this week, the week that we remember doubting Thomas, it's a week to remind all of us, isn't it? That God's unconditional, unmerited favor bathes us. I don't need my feet washed. I need my whole body washed. I don't need drips of water. I need the whole lake.
Congregation may stand. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Anybody else wants to come to the altar, please feel free to do so. You can stay in the pew if you like. They're more comfortable than they've been. Hi, kiddo.
Rejoicing in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we pray for the witness of the church, the wholeness of creation, and all who are in need.
Dear God, you speak peace when we are afraid. Give us courage to show your grace of our lives. Encourage the preachers and teachers to speak your truth. Lord, in your blessing.
Hear our prayer.
Dear God, you create peace when everything is in need. When a storm is raining and winds howl, there is calm. Protect people and animals from the dangers of death. Bring back damaged lands and towns in their normal condition. The winds are missing.
And to announce that the children will receive their milestones after the service is completed. I have one more announcement. What happened to my microphone? It's gone. We've got a birthday celebration going on tomorrow. We've got two of our interns, Rachel and Melissa, share the same birth date. 2 years apart. 19 for Rachel, 17 for Melissa. Happy birthday, young ladies. Happy that the snow's gone.
Yeah.
to us, O Lord, in the breaking of the bread, as you were made known to the disciples. Receive these gifts and the offering of our lives, that we may be your risen body in the world. Amen.
We may show your glory to all the world through the same Jesus Christ, our risen Lord.
May God, who has brought us from death to life, fill you with great joy. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen. Alleluia! Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia!
You are the body of Christ and raised up for the world. Go in peace. Share the good news.